ओम अज्ञानतिमिरान्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनच्छलाकया चक्षुरोन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपः कदा मह्यं ददाति सुपदान्तिकम्। वन्देऽहं श्रीगुरोः श्रीयुतापदकमलं श्रीगुरून् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं सागरजातं सहगणा रघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनासहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधाकृष्णपादान् सहगणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च। हे कृष्णकरुणासिन्धु दीनबन्धु जगत्पते गोपेशा गोपिकाकान्त राधाकान्त नमोस्तुते। तप्तकाञ्चन गौराङ्गी राधे वृन्दावनेश्वरी शुभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये। पंचकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौरभक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमतराधनाथ स्वामी नाम्ने। नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमति भक्तिवेदांत स्वामी नाम्ने। नमस्ते सरस्वती देवी गौरवाणी प्रचारिणी निर्विशेष मुखम करोति वाचालं पंगुं लंघयते गिरिं यत्कृपादमहं वंदे श्रीगुरुं दीन्तारणं परमानन्दमाधवं श्रीचैतन्येश्वरं। हरि ओं तत्सत्। हरे कृष्ण। So I'd like to welcome everyone for the continuation of our Wednesday class. I would also specifically like to welcome Neeraj. I think Prashant ji has introduced Neeraj. So Neeraj, welcome and thanks for joining.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Hope to connect with you one-on-one someday.
Definitely, sir.
Not so distant. Thank you, Neeraj. So, we are continuing our journey on the seventh chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. It's very interesting, very sweet chapter. So, just going to briefly recap what I explained in a significant amount of detail in the last chapter, in the last session. Krishna's instruction at the end of the sixth chapter was that the best possible process of yoga or the topmost yogi is one who fixes his mind on me with devotion and worships me with great bhakti. Shraddhavan bhajate yo mam same yukta tamo mata. So Krishna is devoting the seventh chapter to explain to Arjuna how that undivided absorption in him is possible. And the key point that Krishna is trying to make here is he's trying to give a complete description of himself in principle, a tattvata, because of course God is unlimited, but at least in principle, so that we have a proper understanding of when we say we have to remember Krishna, who is this Krishna? Are we simply remembering Krishna a king? Simply remembering Krishna as a cowherd boy, simply remembering Krishna as a historical personality, or are we properly understanding who Krishna is, tattvatah, as he is? That is very important. Then we will get the proper result. Of course, in any way we connect to Krishna, we get benefit because Krishna is so pure. But when we contemplate on him with a proper understanding, we are able to get full benefit of that absorption. And not only that, when we understand the true glories of Krishna, it is then possible for us to become naturally attracted to him and also fix our mind on him with a firm determination. Because it's very important to be able to do steady spiritual practice that one must have one's intelligence convinced. So by going through the knowledge of the sixth chapter, which is a seventh chapter, which is essentially knowledge of the absolute. Absolute here refers to the supreme truth. So when one understands Krishna to be the Supreme Truth and not just a part of the Supreme Truth, the ultimate Tattva in the Supreme Truth, and how all other Tattvas or aspects of divinity are all coming from him and dependent on him, then one develops an appreciation of the greatness of the personality of Godhead, the Bhagwan aspect. Of how the Bhagwan aspect, the personality, is not just a personality like our personality, which is so limited and constrained to the body, but the Lord, even though he is present everywhere through the Brahman and the Paramatma aspects, even though he is the source of all material and spiritual existences, he is still in the ultimate sense the Supreme Person, Purushottama. Now this idea reverberates across the Bhagavad Gita multiple times in multiple chapters where Krishna again and again emphasizes, please do not misunderstand me that I am simply a temporary form which has come out from the Brahma Jyoti. No. I am the source of everything, including the Brahman. Brahmanohi pratishtaham. I am the source and the basis of the Brahman. So Krishna's personality is understood here in terms of its connection with various other aspects of divinity and energies of divinity. So in the early part of this chapter, and we discussed this in the last session, Krishna starts this chapter by essentially saying that this knowledge that I'm going to give you in this chapter, Arjun, is both material and spiritual. And having known this, nothing else remains for you to know. So Krishna is saying very clearly, this is the last word in terms of a comprehensive understanding of himself. And then he says it's very difficult to get this knowledge and understanding properly. Out of thousands and thousands of men, hardly one person may know me in truth. And then Krishna first starts off explaining his various material and spiritual energies in the context of this manifestation. He explains the material energy as constituting the eight elements: earth, water, fire, air, ether, mind, intelligence, false ego. And then he says, along with the dull material energy, there is also my spiritual energy, the sparks of consciousness, which are also coming from me. Just like the material energy is coming from me, the spiritual sparks, the jivas, the living entities who are my part and parcels eternally, they are also coming from me. Both of these are my energies. One is material, one is spiritual. And I am the source and master of both. So Krishna is clearly differentiated to say that he is not the universe. The universe is his energy. He is also differentiated to say that we are not God. We are his energy. Sometimes some people have this misunderstanding. Oh, I am God. You are God. We have all forgotten. And we are all having a bad dream. And when we wake up from the dream, we will realize we are God. Bhagavad Gita or the scriptures actually do not give this idea anywhere. This is a more modern concoction. Krishna says very clearly, the jivas are my spiritual energy. They are not me, they are my spiritual energy. And this combination of material and spiritual energy is what is creating this manifest universes where we can see so many activities, so many life forms. And ultimately, everything is resting on him. So Krishna concludes the section that we discussed last time with verse 7, where he establishes and says, Arjun, please understand, I am not just the source of both of this, but in case you are having this question, what is my source? Now many people ask, oh, who created God? No. God is that who has no other creator, or that or who has no other creator. Ishvara Parama Krishna Sachidananda Vigraha Anadir Adir Govinda Sarvakarana Karanam. Krishna is Anadir Adir. Anadi means he doesn't have a beginning. But he is Adi. He is the source of everything. So the Supreme Param Brahman. The Brahman is the Brahma Jyoti, impersonal effulgence. But the Parabrahman, from whom the Brahman comes, is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who has no other beginning. This is the prayer by Lord Brahma. मत्ता परतरम नान्यत किंचिदस्ति धनंजय सर्वम इदं मया प्रोतम सूत्रे मणिगण इव एवरीथिंग इज रेस्टिंग ऑन मी लाइक पर्ल्स आर स्ट्रंग ऑन अ एंड देयर इज नो ट्रुथ विच इज सुपीरियर टू मी अर्जुन आई एम द फाइनल वर्ड इन स्पिरिचुअल अंडरस्टैंडिंग सो दिस इज द अंडरस्टैंडिंग विद विच वी हैव टू रिमेंबर कृष्ण. So when we approach Krishna, we do not approach him like, maybe I should contact this friend, maybe I should contact that, maybe this time I contact Krishna and try to see whether he can solve my problem. If he cannot, then maybe I'll go to some other place, some other temple, some other powerful person to try to sort out my problem. Matta parataram nanyat kinchit. There is no truth superior to. So having established this, we continue on from verse number 8, where Krishna then spends the next few verses discussing how even within this material manifestation, he can be perceived and appreciated through the presence of his energies, because he is the essence of various essential phenomena within this material world that we see. See, the Lord in his spiritual form is spiritual. He's in the spiritual world. So we cannot see him directly, at least with these eyes, at least at this moment where we are conditioned. But we can see the Lord in creation indirectly through the presence of his energies. Yes? So when you see a very, very rich person's big palace, big organization, his guards, how everything is so nicely structured. You are, even though in one sense not seeing him, you're also seeing him, because that, what you're seeing is an extension of that powerful person. It is his opulence. It is his energy. And by seeing the energy, you can remember the energetic. Yes, I was in Brunei a couple of years ago, and we were just on a day trip, and we were just going around the city in a taxi, and we were passing the king's palace, the Brunei Sultan. So the taxi driver was explaining to us, "Oh yeah, this is the Sultan of Brunei. He's so nice. He's a ruler. We all love him. This." And of course, I wasn't very close to the palace, I was seeing. But then suddenly, as we were driving, just next to us, the Sultan passed in his car. Just coincidentally, he happened to pass in the car. And suddenly the taxi driver said, yeah, see, this is the Sultan. Actually, I realized a bit late, so I didn't quite see the Sultan, but, you know, just seeing the car, and seeing the pomp of that car, you have a feeling that you have seen the king, the Sultan. So sometimes you may not be able to see the person behind it, but you can gauge the power of the person behind by seeing his opulence and his energies working. When you see that, you know, huge car, when you see the number of guards, of course, in that case, he was just going in his car by himself. Brunei is quite a safe place generally. Doesn't require a big cavalcade of guards accompanying in either direction. But that power, that display, that gives us a hint. Oh, how powerful this person must be. So in this material creation, which is just a part of the energy of God, Ekam Shena Stito Jagat, the Lord says in the Bhagavad Gita, with one small tiny fragment of myself, I pervade this entire material existence. It's not that the entire material existence is all of God's power. He says, this is just, and whatever great things you see there, just a tiny spark of my splendor, Krishna said elsewhere in the Gita. But he's saying that when you see these great things in nature, and when you see how that essence of those energies in this world is the very basis of sustenance of life and for this whole world to function, you should understand that actually you are seeing me. Because I am present or I am active in the form of that active principle in those essential things which drive this existence. So when you see those things, you can actually remember me. So Krishna gives a few examples. So Krishna starts by saying, Rasoham Mapsu Kaunteya Prabhasmi Sashi Surya Yoho Pranavaha Sarva Vedeshu Shabdaha Khe Paurusham Nrishu. Krishna says, water, we all live on water. And we all relish the taste of water. Nobody likes salty sea water, right? We all want fresh water. So that taste of fresh water, that thirst quenching taste, Krishna says, I am that essential principle. So why is Krishna saying that? Krishna is saying that every time we drink water, we can remember, oh, the taste of this water is Krishna. How many times we drink water in a day? So many times. So every gulp of water, we can remember Krishna. He says, I am the light of the sun and the moon. Can we run away from the light of the sun and the moon? And the sun and the moon and their light are so essential for life. Of course, most of us know the importance of sunlight, but many of us do not know the importance of moonlight. In fact, moonlight, the scriptures say, and modern science doesn't acknowledge this yet very much, but moonlight is also very important for vegetables and fruits and others, the vegetation to develop taste. It is said moonlight is very important for that. So modern science is still yet to discover that aspect of moonlight. So I am the light of the sun and the moon. The sunlight practically sustaining all existence. And that is my energy. So the scriptures say the sunshine, this bright, all-pervading light that comes from the sun, the source of that light is the Supreme Brahman. Is the Brahma Jyoti, and the source of the Brahma Jyoti is Krishna. So ultimately, sunlight is a manifestation of Krishna's light. So many times scriptures compare God and his knowledge to sun and the sunlight. Krishna Surya Sama Maya Haya Andhakar. Ha Krishna Taha Nahi Maya Radhi. Krishna says, I am the Om in all the Vedic mantras. Practically all Vedic mantras begin with Om. And Om is the sound representation of God. Some people like to address the Lord personally by calling him Krishna, Govinda, Madhava, Madhusudan. These are his personal names. But some people are not so fond of God's personality. They like to think of God as that supreme principle behind everything. The difference is like, you know, calling the prime minister or president by his name or by his title. Yeah. So for example, in India, either you can say Narendra Modi or you can say Mr. Prime Minister. You're referring to the same person. One is a more formal representation. One is a personal address. So Om is the impersonal sound, actually not impersonal, but is the sound representation of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Om iti ekaksharam brahma, the scriptures say. And that's why all Vedic mantras are prefixed by Om. Om tad vishnoho paramam padam sada pashyanti surayah. Practically all the Vedic mantras begin with Om. And this Om, Krishna is saying, is his representation. Krishna then says, I am the sound in ether. And in man, I am ability. Any kind of ability, the active principle to make that ability possible is Krishna, is coming from Krishna. So you see how dependent and how dependent we are on Krishna. Because Krishna is so all pervasive in all ways. How can we run away from this fact? Punyo gandha prithivyam prithivyam cha tejas chasmi vibhavasau jivanam sarva bhuteshu tapas chasmi tapasvishu. I am the original fragrance of the earth. Krishna says, original fragrance, punya gandha. How many of you have experienced, you know, when the earth is scorched and then suddenly the first rains come after a long time? And then when the rain touches the ground, how the beautiful smell of the earth. The cities, this may not be very apparent, but sometimes we are able to smell it also. But on the earth, when the water falls, how that smell from the earth, the pure fragrance of the earth comes. And that fragrance is so enlivening and purifying. It's so beautiful, actually. In fact, the scriptures say that all the scents, all the perfumes are actually coming from the earth. And it is said the plants, especially the aromatic plants, they draw the specific aromatic fragrances and the related chemicals from the earth. Then they are manifested in the flowers. That's how it is explained. Punyo gandha prithivyam cha tejas chasmi vibhavasau. I am the heat in the fire. Vibhavasau. How essential is fire? Absolutely. Without fire, we practically cannot do anything. And Krishna says, I am the heat. So Krishna is making all cooking possible, all energetic work possible. Not only cooking externally, but even the digestion within the stomach. The digestive fire also is Krishna. Pachamyannam chaturvidam. In another chapter, another verse, Krishna says, I am the one who's pranapana samayuktaha pachamyannam chaturvidam. So we are dependent on Krishna even for digestion. Even to taste, the ability to eat also we are dependent. The food also because of the sunlight is coming. Where is Krishna not involved? He is involved everywhere. The problem is we are forgetful of him. We are so lost in our ego that we are unable to perceive how he is making everything possible. Just think about it. Are we even aware what is happening in our own bodies? How many of us can claim that, you know, I have properly planned my digestive process? How many of us know even what is happening as soon as we, you know, gulp something? We have no idea. Krishna has designed in such a way that everything that is necessary to digest, assimilate, absorb, distribute the energy, everything is managed. And we have zero contribution consciously in it. And when the process comes to its logical end, next day, the body will tell you, knock, knock, knock. Let us go to the small room to clear whatever is not required. So we have all the abilities also that our body, our heart is pumping. How many of us have any clue about what is happening? So such an amazing way the Lord has made all of this possible. Krishna says, I am the life of all that lives. And I am the tapaha of all the ascetics. Bijam mam sarva bhutanam viddhi partha sanatanam buddhir buddhimadam asmi tejas tejasvinam aham. I am the original seed of all existences. Krishna says, he is the seed. Elsewhere in the Gita, the Lord also says, pitaham asya jagata dhata mata pitamaha. I am the father, I am the mother, I am the grandfather of all living entities. Krishna says, I am the seed. No life will be possible without my active involvement. If you remember, even in the earlier process of creation, how Krishna has to enter into every step to make it possible. Because ultimately, like Krishna has himself explained in the 7th verse of this chapter, he is the very basis of everything. Just like pearls are strung on the thread. So everything comes from him, rests on him, is controlled by him, owned by him. So beautiful. but everything is not him. And Krishna explains this in the next few verses. So everything is within me, based on me, and coming from me. I am still maintaining my independent existence as the Supreme Personality of God. But we'll come to that in a couple of verses. So here in 7.10, Krishna says, I'm the original seed, Bijam Mam Vidhi Sarva Bhutanam, all living entities. Bija, the seed. Vidhi Partha Sanatanam. Buddhir Buddhimatam Asmi, any intelligence we have, that ability of intelligence. And Tejas Tejas Vinamaham, the power or the prowess of those who are extraordinary. I am that Arjun. Sometimes we become so proud. Oh, I am so beautiful. I am so smart. I have such wonderful abilities. But if we think deeply enough, it shouldn't be very hard for us to understand that actually we cannot claim credit for any of this. Because we have just been granted these abilities when we are born. Maybe because of our karma, but we are not the designers of these abilities. Isn't it? How many beautiful people can claim that before they were born, they did a lot of designing, nice aesthetic designing of their facial features and bodily features, and then designed it and then were born like that? No. We cannot. Niraj will take questions toward the end. Yeah. So, Buddhir Buddhivatam Asmi Tejas Tejas Vinamaham. That I am the ability or the prowess in all those who have extraordinary prowess. That's why Krishna is saying, in the Upanishads it is said, Katha Upanishad, Nityo Nityanam Chetanas Chetananam Eko Bahunam Yuvidhati Kama. That so many living entities are there, but the Lord is the source as well as the maintainer, Vishvambhara, supreme maintainer of the entire existence. And everything is ultimately coming from Him, material and spiritual. Balam balavatam chaham kama raga vivarjitam dharma viruddha bhuteshu kamosmi paratarshava. I am the strength of those who are strong. Balam balavatam chaham. And especially that kind of bala is especially representative of Krishna, which is used in the right way, in the dharmic way, and which is devoid of passion and desire. Also, Krishna says, even the act of progeny, even the act of procreation is His energy and it is Him, as long as it is used in the right way for the propagation for God-conscious population. So this is how the Lord says that He is present everywhere. Ye chaiva sattvika bhava rajas rajasas tamasaschi matta eveti tantan viddhi natvaham teshu te mai. Please understand, Arjun, that all the states of being which are manifested in this material world, especially the three guna, sattva guna, rajoguna, tamoguna, they're all manifested by my energy. These are all different qualities of my energy. In one sense, Arjuna, in a very liberal way, you can say, I am everything. Why? Because everything comes from me and is dependent on, nothing is independent of me. So in one sense, everything is me. But that shouldn't mislead you to think that everything is me. Again, I repeat this point again and again, and Krishna also repeats this point again and again, because this is a very, 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 very important part of the understanding. And this is the most difficult part of the understanding in spiritual life. How God is everything, still God is different from it. And unless we properly understand this principle, we'll be misled into some of the partial truths regarding understanding of God. But here in 7th chapter, Krishna is explaining Himself in full. In truth, He says, I am in one sense everything, but I am still independent. I exist independent of this material energy. I am not influenced by these gunas, by the material energy. I am not influenced by Maya. The living entities are. Because this energy is coming from me. It's under my control. Everything is within me, Arjun. But I maintain my independent existence. Very beautiful. The Lord is never affected by the gunas. The jivas are affected by the gunas. But the manifestation of the gunas is made possible by the energy of the Lord. And these gunas are directly under the control of the Lord always. The Lord is never overwhelmed. Devi hi esha gunamai mama maya duratyaya mama eva ye prapadyante maya metam tarantiti. Elsewhere Krishna says that these divine energy, I am controlling it, and those who surrender to me, they are liberated from it. And something similar is echoed in the 13th verse. Tribhir gunamayir bhavair ebhi sarvam idam jagat mohitam nabhi janati mamebhya paramavyayam. The living entities in this world, Arjun, who have not achieved the perfection of consciousness and whose consciousness is still affected by the material qualities of sattva, raja, tama, they are unable to know me and my spiritual truth properly. Because I am beyond matter. I am beyond the modes. And I am inexhaustible. Avyaya, I am never affected. I never change. Avyaya means no change. No change with time. Not impacted by the happenings of this material world. So this material world, there are of course different gunas and different kinds of living entities are situated in different gunas. The Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudras. This topic will be discussed in greater detail in chapter 14. Suffice to mention that the Brahmanas are predominantly in the mode of goodness. Kshatriyas are a mix of goodness and passion. Vaishyas are a mixture of passion and ignorance. And Shudras are predominantly in ignorance. But to understand Krishna in truth, of course, the beginning of understanding Krishna starts in the Sattvagun. Before that, it is very difficult to have any appreciation of the spiritual. But the proper understanding of Krishna and realization comes only after transcending the modes. Not even simply by the mode of goodness. But one has to first come to the mode of goodness to begin any serious process, a progress in spiritual life. Here 7.14, we just discussed this. Daivi hyesha gunamai mama maya duratyaya mamevai prapadyante maya metam tarantite. Krishna says this three modes which is harassing every living entity. Gunamai, comprising the gunas, this material energy, is very difficult to overcome. People are unable to see the truth and they are trapped by these three modes in various ways. But Arjun, if somebody wants to actually transcend the limitations of these gunas, transcend their binding and illusory effect and be able to perceive the truth, ultimately me as I am, then the actual way to become free from the modes is actually very simple. You cannot fight the modes and head on and take them, and try to overcome them. It's just like, when there's a tsunami coming, you cannot open your umbrella and say, okay, I will stop the tsunami with my umbrella. Everything will be swept away. The material energy is so powerful. It's an ocean. What can you do? With all our arrangements. You see, even in this material world, nature is always so powerful. When there is a cyclone, when there is a tornado, when there is an earthquake, what can you do? The only thing you can do is just run to save your life. Material nature is very, very powerful. Duratyaya, extremely difficult to overcome. But Krishna says, Mam eva ye prapadyante. Those who take shelter of me alone, Mam eva ye prapadyante. Mayam etam taranti. This illusory energy, they are able to transcend without any difficulty. Taranti, they can overcome. Correct. So Prabhupada sometimes gives a wonderful example. So just like you go to the house of a rich man, very rich man, and you try to enter his house. Suddenly, a huge, big dog, who's a pet of this particular rich man, comes barking at you, runs from the house. He sees that you are trying to enter, rushes, bah, 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 jumping and is about to bite. You are running around trying to save yourself. You don't know, you are unable to fight. That huge hound . But then you see the master from a distance and you say, help, help. Sir, please help me. Your dog is attacking me. The master just calls out to the dog and tells him to, you know, be peaceful and pacified. And as soon as the master says, immediately the dog becomes pacified, comes back to his master and remains next to him. And stops harassing us. Because ultimately, that barking dog is under the control of his master. We may not be able to tackle the dog, but the dog has a master, and the master can control the dog very easily. So Maya is like that. Maya is hounding us, this illusory energy. Trigunamai esha mam maya duratya. If we surrender to the master can order the dog, and he also has the chains to hold the dog. The dog is not unleashed on us. That's why Krishna says, Mama Maya. What does that Mama mean? Mama Maya means, my Maya is my energy. It's under my control. I can turn it on, I can turn it off. Those who rebel against me, those who break the laws of nature, those sinful activities, it is turned on. As living entities start surrendering to me, slowly, slowly, the dial goes to the left, finally goes off. Mam eva ye prapadyante, mayam etam tanantite. And Krishna especially says, mam eva, surrender to me, the supreme truth. Not just to some powerful personality, not just even to another devata. And this particular point is discussed in more detail in the subsequent verses of this chapter itself. Krishna emphasizes ultimately, if you want to become free from Maya, even all the devatas are not free from Maya. So if you want to be free from Maya, you must take shelter of Bhukti Pradata Sarvesham Vishnur Evana Samshaya. To become liberated, one has to take shelter of Krishna, Vishnu, or one of their direct expansions. So I want to take a pause here, because actually the next two verses are actually very beautiful, very elaborate, 7.15, 7.16, and the next couple of verses. And I want to, you know, devote one whole class based on that, because these two verses are very, very important. It speaks about the four kinds of people who go away from God and four kinds of people who take shelter of God. Very nicely, very beautiful example. So if somebody is asking, how do I categorize those people who are not taking shelter of God? Krishna says very clearly in 7.15, Namam duskritino mudha prapadyante naradama Mayaya parata jnana asuram bhavam ashritah. And then what kind of people take shelter of God? Chaturveda bhajante mam jana sukritin arjuna artha artharti jigyasu jnani cha bharatarshava. So these two verses and the next couple of verses after that, four or five of them, I think, up to 19 if I'm not wrong, we'll discuss in great detail tomorrow. But I want to spend some time opening up the floor to discuss any questions on what we have discussed so far. So what Krishna is doing in the rest of the chapter is, after this, he will discuss the two kinds of people, like what I mentioned, four categories of those who don't worship him and four categories of those who worship him. Then Krishna goes into a very interesting section to describe about devatas. What is the position of the devatas? What is the relationship between him and the devatas? And what is the difference between worshipping him and worshipping any other devatas? That is discussed in great detail. So this is very, very beautiful section. Then Krishna also hints at what is the relationship between him and the impersonal Brahman, and which is higher. So all these aspects are covered very beautifully. And of course, Krishna concludes the chapter by re-emphasizing how it is so important to understand him properly like this and take full shelter of him without any deviation. So I'm going to open up the floor for any questions or comments. Niraj is asking, did Krishna choose Arjun or Arjun chose Krishna? In what sense do you mean chose? Niraj, I'm not very clear what is the question.
Sir, can I say, I have not read Gita completely, but what I've heard from my parents or from my friends as well who have done, I just wanted to know, Arjun was the main character in the entire Bhagavad Gita along with Krishna, and there were other few characters as well, but why only Arjun?
Why only Arjun? Of course, Krishna uses Arjun as a means to spread the knowledge of the Bhagavad Gita through him as the instrument. But why specifically him? Why not anybody else? So Krishna explains this in the Bhagavad Gita. He says, Bhaktosi cha, Bhaktosi me sakha chaiti rahasyam hi etad uttamam. This knowledge is very, very deep secret. And only those who are very dear to me, devoted to me, those who are my devotees and very close to me, they can actually understand and appreciate this knowledge in the true sense. So that's why, Arjuna, I have chosen you to become the recipient of this knowledge and ultimately through you to make this knowledge available to everybody. So Krishna was able to, Arjuna was able to understand it because he had this qualification that he was a great devotee of Krishna. And that is why when he was put into this very difficult situation, he takes shelter of Krishna and asks him for guidance. So in that sense, you can say that Krishna chose Arjun, if that's what your question is. But that was the basis of his choosing.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Good. Any other questions?
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Yes.
Ultimately, if you were see in chapter 11 and so on, it is mentioned that we are supposed to remember Krishna in his two armed form and so on. So basically, what I'm trying to understand is that although as an practicing devotees, okay, sometimes we it is extremely difficult at times for us to be, let's say, what is that? Is that focus on this two hand formed and what is that? So on. But if we have accepted that Krishna is the supreme, and then based on his opulence and all those things, ultimately, if we what is that, surrender to him, are we also in the one right path and so on? You get my question.
No, I'm not very sure what you are trying to see. Krishna we can see when we remember the Lord, we can remember him various ways. We can either remember him directly or indirectly. Yeah. So direct way of remembering him is obviously directly thinking of his form, activities, you know, pastimes, yeah, like the residents of Vrindavan. They are directly remembering Krishna very, very personally. But there are other ways to remember God also, maybe not directly in his personal form, but by appreciating his presence and energies in various ways and relating those things back to him. The connection is still there. The remembrance is there. But the remembrance, you know, may be slightly indirect and coming through his either energies or his opulences, either through his shaktis or through his vaibhav. So that is also another way. And here the Lord is giving some examples of his, you know, energetic presence, which we can remember. I am the taste in water. And we remember, oh, this taste is a manifestation of the essence of the Lord. In that way, we remember him. So there are things which may lead us to remember him. But again, what is it that we are focusing on? Right? I mean, remembrance of the Lord in any way is auspicious and will lead to purification. But what Prabhupada is saying in the purport is that if we want to transcend maya, mam eva ye prapadyante maya metam tarantite, we must worship the transcendent Lord. That is the point. Transcendent Lord means that Lord who is beyond the material manifestation. The key point here is that if a living entity, either a jiva like us, no matter how powerful, or even a devata for that matter, all the way up to Brahma, anyone who is created in this world and who is still influenced by the gunas, the scriptures say that those who are still influenced by the gunas cannot liberate somebody who's in the gunas. That is why it says, Mukti Pradata Sarvesham Vishnur Evana Samshaya. That it is Lord Vishnu and the expansions of Vishnu who can liberate. So that is why we want to take shelter of the transcendental Lord. They can liberate us. Right? Even when Hiranyakashipu went to Brahma, and he asked Brahma, give me immortality. Brahma said, I have to die. What can I give you? Immortality. So that is the key point that the Lord is saying. Of course, for those who want to achieve Goloka, of course, to be free from matter and to overcome Maya, one can remember any transcendent form of the Lord. Vishnu, Rama, Narasingha, Vamana, Krishna, all of these are transcendent. But if one wants to go and achieve a particular rasa or relationship with a particular form of the Lord, obviously, one has to focus one's attention on that form. So the recommendation, especially for those like us who are aspiring for a relationship with the original Supreme Personality of Godhead, Shri Krishna, Govindam Adi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami, then we should try to remember and recollect the original form of Lord as Govinda, as Krishna. Yeah, does that answer your question?
Yes, Prabhu. Thanks.
Thank you. Any other question?
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Yes, Satiji, Hare Krishna.
So, my question is like demigod worshippers and the person who worship Lord Supreme, does it reach to the same Supreme abode?
Those who worship Krishna and those who worship
demigods.
So that Krishna will be, Krishna will answer it in the next few verses. So we'll keep that for the next few classes. Krishna answers this question very, very explicitly in a shloka which is dedicated to your question. He knew you would be asking it today on the 2nd of June. Okay, so he has specifically answered. So if you want
to answer, okay, thank you. We'll look forward to it.
You can read the next few verses. So I'll keep the suspense open for the others. Yeah, but I think you can guess the answer. The answer is quite clearly that.
Yes.
Yeah, but it is different. And Krishna emphasizes that. Just because you catch a flight doesn't mean you go to, you know, New York. If you catch a flight to London, you go to London. You don't reach New York. If you catch a flight to Kuching, you will reach Kuching. Huh? So you cannot just say go to airport, sit in any flight, you will reach New York. That is not how it works. So
it's not yes, that I know the answer, but so many people, they ask these questions to me.
Yes. So you can tell them what Krishna says. See, the problem is people fight based on each other's opinion. We are not fighting based on our opinion. It's not that we are saying it is like this because we worship Krishna. We're not saying that. We are worshiping Krishna because Krishna is like this. And who is saying that? The scriptures are saying that. The greatest of the devatas, Lord Purushottam. Brahma, Lord Shiva, and all the other personalities are saying that. Lord Ganesh, he wrote the Bhagavad Gita. All these shlokas are written down by Ganesh. How could he write down something which is incorrect? Especially when Vyasadeva had given him that condition. So Krishna very specifically addresses this section about the relationship between the devatas and himself in this chapter. We'll come to that probably not in the next class, but the next to next class. But very clearly, if we worship some person or something which is still within the material realm and still not transcendental, then one cannot achieve a transcendental result. That is the basic principle. Yeah, one attains the state on which one always contemplates. That's why sometimes, even if one contemplates on Krishna without knowing he is Krishna, because he is so powerful and transcendental, one gradually becomes purified. That is the amazing thing about Krishna. But if you think somebody to be God and he is not God, he is still under the influence of modes of nature. Even if you think him to be God and worship him, you cannot transcend. That is the beauty. That's why even the great Asuras also achieved liberation, because they were always thinking of Krishna, whether it was Shishupal, whether it was Kamsa, whether it was Ravan. Asura Sakala Pailo Charana. When all the Asuras, because of their constant absorption in the transcendent Lord, eventually got purified. That is the greatness of Krishna. So we will discuss this in more detail. It's a very vast topic, but thank you. You are very concerned about enlightening everybody. So we have given them an early glimpse of the next few chapters. Thank you.
Thank you, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Yes, Bhaskar.
Prabhuji, how do we understand this statement like Vasudevam Sarvamiti Samatma Sudurlabha? So, I mean,
yes, Krishna has explained in this chapter, right? Sorry, you want to complete your question?
Yeah, explain, Prabhuji. I mean, I'm not Vasudevam familiar.
Sarvam means, see, ultimately, there is nothing beyond the Supreme Truth. And Krishna has already said in this chapter, right? Everything that is manifest in this world is either material or spiritual. Correct? Material energy is also coming from him. Krishna is saying spiritual energy is also coming from him. He is the source and the basis of both. And that's why Krishna says ultimately there is nothing outside of him. Yes, correct? You understand?
Yeah, because everything
belongs to him, right?
Yes,
for example, very simple example I'll give you. A very simple example. This is what I'm putting up. You can see what am I putting up now? What is this?
Your palm. Your hand.
This is my hand. This is my palm. Correct?
Yeah.
Is this hand me or is it not me? Is this me or is this not me?
It's you only.
Huh? Is it me? If I take this hand, is this hand me? I am seeing this hand. Yes? So you are right also and you are wrong also. Why? Because this hand is part of me, but is not me. You understand?
Yeah.
Correct? You understand?
Yeah. Yes.
So there is nothing beyond the Lord. Because the Lord says even this whole material manifestation is like his Virata Roop. It's like his whole huge material form. So there's nothing beyond the Lord, but it doesn't mean that is the Lord. So this is my hand. This is my leg. But there is still a me which is beyond this. You understand?
Yeah.
That's how the Lord is trying to say. Vasudeva Sarvam Iti Samatma Sudurlabha. So a person who actually becomes wise in spiritual knowledge ultimately comes to this spiritual realization that everything, the Lord is present everywhere. Everything is energy. but at the same time the transcendental lord goloka eva nivasatya khilatma bhuto govindam adi purusha, still the original supreme personality of god and maintains his independent existence. So vasudeva sarvamiti means one understands that everything is connected to the lord. That is why those who become pure devotees, those who understand this knowledge tattvatah, what Krishna is explaining in the 7th chapter, they, when they see anything in this world, they don't have to be in the temple to remember Krishna. They see anything in this world, it reminds them of Krishna. Because they feel they are seeing Krishna. Rasoham apsu kaunteya prabhasmi sasi surya yoho pranavas sarva vedeshu shabda ke paurusham nrushu. Sunlight, Krishna. Taste, Krishna. Ability, Krishna. Vasudeva sarvamiti, he is permeating everything, he is making everything possible, he is there in everything. Correct? Yeah. Just think of it, you know, just for example, I'm giving a gross example, gross in the sense of mundane, not a gross in that gross sense, but a mundane example. So let's say a boy is madly in love with a girl. Correct? Yeah. So let's say one day he meets that girl. And accidentally, after the meeting, when the girl goes, the girl leaves her handkerchief behind. Accidentally. Handkerchief. Okay. This scene is there in many movies, olden movies. So I think, you know, many of us may have seen it. So the girl has gone. So the boy takes this handkerchief and he goes back home. Yeah. And then he's not able to meet that girl for a long, long time. But whenever he's feeling absence of that girl, what he does? Takes out that handkerchief and he sees. And when he sees that handkerchief and he smells that handkerchief, then he embraces that handkerchief. What is the feeling that he's getting? He's feeling as if he's not seeing the handkerchief, he's seeing his girlfriend. Correct?
True. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, that means you have experience. I don't, so it'd be true. Anyway, I'm just joking. Okay. So when a person can see the connection of something with someone, when he sees that something, it automatically reminds him of that someone. Yes, because he can very clearly see that connection. Yeah. Yeah. So just like when he sees the handkerchief, he can. Or whenever he passes even the road where his girlfriend stays, he'll always remember, oh, this is the gully on which my, and there are so many songs and poetry which are sung about the lane on which the beloved stays. So people romanticize this so much because just those things which are connected to the beloved so strongly evoke remembrance of the beloved. So those who are properly in knowledge of Krishna. Is there something which is not connected to Krishna? Is it just that the handkerchief for the girlfriend probably is just the handkerchief, her lane, her house, her car, her dog, her books, her car, her parents, her family, whatever else. But as far as Krishna is concerned, everything is connected to Krishna. That is what Krishna is saying. I am the light of the sunshine. I am the ability in man. I am the taste of water. I am the seed of all existences. I am the Omkar. Vasudeva Sarvamiti. How to not remember him? For a person who is in knowledge, he sees Krishna everywhere. In this way. Because he is always able to understand whose property is this that he is seeing. You understand?
Yes, Prabhuji, I understand. Yeah, okay. Thank you very much.
That is the understanding. Hare Krishna. So we have to make Krishna our beloved. So when we make Krishna our beloved, then everything that we see in this world will evoke very strong remembrance of him. And that is the vision of the great souls. That is what actually it means, Vasudeva Sarvam. They can see Krishna everywhere in that way.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Anything else? Hare Krishna. Any other point? Okay, fine. So, if no other questions, please read through this. This is a very, very important chapter. Yeah, so after reading this entire chapter, if you properly understand this chapter, you will fall in love with Krishna. So until you fall in love, you have to go on reading. Because the right fruit, and this is not again my speculation, yeah, elsewhere in the Gita, the Lord says that when you actually understand me as I am, you cannot but fall in love with me. Because Krishna is just so great, so wonderful, so sweet. And the amazing thing about Krishna is, why he's so endearing, why he's so lovely, is not just that he is very powerful. That is of course there. But Krishna is so extraordinarily powerful, so unlimitedly powerful. But you know what's so wonderful about him? In spite of being that, he is so extremely loving, caring, affectionate, compassionate, forgiving to each and every person. You cannot even imagine how loving and caring and affectionate he is. And as we get closer to him and as we discover through his grace how loving and affectionate he is, we will become overwhelmed by his loving qualities. We cannot but fall in love with him. He's so extraordinary. So if you develop a relationship with him, you will never ever regret it. You will see that is the best thing that you have ever done in all existence. Really, really amazing. Okay? Shri Krishna Bhagavan ki jai. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai. Yes.